Okay, friends, so this gets us to our next question, that is question number 82. Question 82. Bone marrow in AL amyloidosis shows answer is bone marrow plasmacytosis. Our question 82, the answer is A, that is it shows bone marrow plasmacytosis. Bone marrow plasmacytosis. First point, let us start with amyloidosis. I need not even tell you that amyloidosis, it is deposition of abnormally folded protein. It is deposition of abnormally folded protein. Next point, coming to the various diseases associated with the protein deposit, primary amyloidosis, the protein is AL, amyloid light chain, versus secondary or the reactive amyloidosis, where the protein getting deposited is AA. Next, multiple myeloma is associated with primary or secondary? Primary amyloidosis. Multiple myeloma is primary amyloidosis, versus the most common cause of secondary or reactive amyloidosis is rheumatoid arthritis. Most common cause, rheumatoid arthritis. Next point, hemodialysis associated amyloidosis. The protein getting deposited is beta 2 microglobulin. Hemodialysis associated amyloidosis, beta 2 microglobulin. Next, which thyroid cancer is associated with amyloid deposit? Medullary carcinoma thyroid. Next point, medullary carcinoma thyroid, and the amyloid getting deposited or the protein getting deposited in that is ACAL, that is amyloid calcitonin. Next, these four are extremely basic. The question was asked on AL, it is multiple myeloma, so it shows the presence of plasmacytosis. This was the question. These four are basic. Next, coming to hereditary amyloidosis, this is where mainly the question comes from, hereditary amyloidosis. Now, there are three main hereditary amyloidosis, which are familial Mediterranean fever, next, systemic senile amyloidosis, and the last is familial amyloidotic neuropathies. So hereditary amyloidosis, there are three hereditary amyloidosis: familial Mediterranean fever, systemic senile amyloidosis, and familial amyloidotic neuropathies, which are the proteins getting deposited. Familial Mediterranean fever, AA. So secondary amyloidosis and familial Mediterranean fever, it's the same, versus the other two, which is transthyretin. I'm not interested in telling you that systemic senile is wild type of transthyretin versus familial amyloidotic neuropathies, which is mutated transthyretin. Not interested. Next, differentiate systemic senile amyloidosis, which is a hereditary amyloidosis, from localized amyloidosis, that is senile cerebral amyloidosis, where the protein is A-beta. Senile cerebral amyloidosis is also called as Alzheimer's disease. Senile cerebral, which is A-beta. So do not get confused between senile cerebral, which is A-beta, versus hemodialysis associated, which is beta 2 microglobulin. These are the amyloidosis. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question number 83. Now, 74 female with renal failure with hemodialysis, she complains of weakness and palpitations, anemic, and is given a dose of erythropoietin. Erythropoietin stimulates which intermediate in hematopoiesis? Now, the only point for which the question was asked was, erythropoietin stimulates which intermediate? And the answer to question 83 is CFUE, that is colony forming unit. Question 83, the answer is E, that is colony forming unit erythroid. Colony forming unit erythroid. Now this is an important topic, has to be dealt well. See, dekho bache, how does erythroid maturation occur? Normal erythroid maturation. First is the multipotent stem cell. The first cell is the multipotent stem cell, which in turn forms burst forming unit erythroid, which is BFUE, burst forming unit erythroid. This burst forming unit erythroid in turns form colony forming unit erythroid, CFUE, colony forming unit erythroid, which goes to proerythroblast stage. This is normal erythroid maturation. The multipotent stem cell, which in turn goes to the burst forming unit erythroid, in turn to colony forming unit erythroid, and then is the proerythroblast. So I can safely say proerythroblast is the first recognizable cell. This is the first recognizable cell in red cell lineage. First recognizable cell in red cell lineage. This is the most primitive one. This is the most primitive, and this is the first recognizable cell in the erythroid lineage. Next point, erythropoietin stimulates colony forming unit. Erythropoietin, that is EPO, it is firstly released from the kidney. It is released from kidney in response to hypoxia or anemia. It is released from the kidney in response to hypoxia. In response to hypoxia and anemia. Next point, this was very obvious. What is important is the basophilic erythroblast and proerythroblast. Basophilic erythroblast and proerythroblast. They are not affected by erythropoietin. Next, their numbers increase because of increased CFUE. Their numbers increase because of increased colony forming unit erythroid. So erythropoietin is increasing all the red cells predominantly on its action on CFUE, colony forming unit erythroid. CFUE, I can safely say colony forming unit erythroid is completely dependent. CFUE is completely dependent on erythropoietin. It is completely dependent on erythropoietin. This is normal erythroid maturation. This was important. So colony forming unit erythroid is increasing, as a result of which the more maturer forms of RBCs in turn increase. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 84. Adult who develops PRCA should explicitly be evaluated for pure red cell aplasia is classically associated with thymoma. There are numerous causes for PRCA, but it is classically associated with thymoma. This is important and has to be remembered. Next point. Another question that is asked with respect to PRCAs. In PRCA, it's only the erythroid lineage that is affected versus aplastic anemia, in which all three lineages, erythroid, myeloid, as well as megakaryocytic, all three lineages are affected. So, PRCA can progress to aplastic anemia. If the other two lineages also become abnormal, PRCA can progress to aplastic anemia. But aplastic anemia does not progress to PRCA. This is another point which is asked with respect to PRCA. Next, this gets us to our next one, that is question 85. 80 male, pain in upper portion of neck, regurgitates undigested food shortly after eating. Most likely etiology, answer is Zinker's diverticulum. See, Zinker's diverticulum, it is an outpouching in the upper part of esophagus. Now, the history says that it is swelling in the upper portion of the neck with regurgitation of undigested food. As a result, what is happening is the patient has a diverticulum in the upper portion, Zinker's diverticulum. What happens is there is an outpouching, so the food regurgitates. Of course, this is undigested because it is not reaching the stomach. So before we go further, let us have a look at Zinker's. First point, location. It is present in the upper part of the esophagus, above upper esophageal sphincter. Next point, what is present above the upper esophageal sphincter? Pharynx. So this is a pharyngoesophageal diverticula. Next point, location. I'm okay with the fact that this is pharyngoesophageal, but which special triangle or which special area? It is present in Killian's triangle. Killian's triangle, you know this very well from anatomy. It is formed by a muscle which has two branches, thyropharyngeus and cricopharyngeus. These two branches, they are supplied by two different nerves. As a result, because of neuromuscular incoordination in elderly, it is associated with diverticular formation. What we mean is, this is the esophageal wall. In a young individual, this is tight. So when the intraesophageal pressure increases, there is no diverticular. Versus in the elderly, there is neuromuscular incoordination. This wall is lax, leading to formation of a diverticular in case of increased pressure. That is Zinker's diverticular. Next point, most common symptom. Most common symptom, it is associated with dysphagia. Of course, halitosis, regurgitation of food and other symptoms are also seen. This is Zinker's. Next, is it a true diverticula or a pseudo-diverticula? It is a pseudo-diverticula. That is Zinker's diverticula. Next, this gets us to our next question. That is question 87. Let us have a look at this. Question 86. Now, what it says is, middle-aged man complaining of increased difficulty in swallowing, a feeling of pressure for 2 to 3 seconds after swallowing solid food, regurgitation, manometry shows absence of esophageal peristalsis. This is the main word here. Absence of esophageal peristalsis with swallowing and LES that fails to relax. Diagnosis, HLCA cardia. Question 86, the answer is A, that is HLCA cardia. Let us have a look at this. The name tells you everything. The food is not moving. HLCA cardia. So first point, HLCA, this is the classical triad of, this is triad, it has three things, that is incomplete relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter, incomplete relaxation of LES, increased LES tone, and aperistaltic esophagus. Please note, esophagus has no contractions, aperistaltic esophagus. So Echelsia cardia is the classical triad of incomplete relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter, increased tone, and aperistaltic esophagus. Next point, pathogenesis. Let us have a look at how it develops. Pathogenesis. See, normally, how does the lower esophageal sphincter relax? Normally, the lower esophageal relaxation, LES relaxation, it occurs by two mechanisms. The first is there is release of nitric oxide and VIP from inhibitory neurons. There is release of nitric oxide and vasoactive intestinal peptide from the inhibitory neurons. Plus there is interruption of the normal cholinergic signaling. There is interruption of the normal cholinergic signaling. This is what happens normally. See, cholinergic signaling is increasing LES tone. So interruption of the normal cholinergic signaling plus release of nitric oxide and VIP from inhibitory neurons. So two things contribute towards the relaxation. Next point, in Echelsia cardia, that is in Echelsia, there is selective loss of function of inhibitory neurons. That is, they were supposed to cause relaxation, but they are not doing so. Selective loss of function of inhibitory neurons. The cholinergic signaling pathway is intact, but there is loss of function of inhibitory neurons, in turn leading to increased LES tone and incomplete relaxation of lower esophageal sphincter. Next point, types of Echelsia. Types of Echelsia cardia. Firstly, primary. It is the primary Echelsia, which is associated with ganglion cell degeneration. Let me write it as, instead of degeneration of ganglion cells, it is associated with ganglion cell degeneration. Occurring because of an unknown cause. This is primary versus secondary Echelsia, which is mainly because of Chagas disease. Why does Chagas disease occur? You know this much better than me from microbio, Trypanosoma cruzi. Chagas disease or Trypanosoma cruzi, that is secondary Echelsia. Lastly, diagnosis, the investigation of choice for Echelsia cardia is manometry. That is, we are measuring the pressure. Manometry. Barium swallow shows a bird beak or a rat tail appearance. I am sure this would very well have been shown to you in radiology, because this can even be a picture based question. Think of it yourself, when the person has taken barium, it is seeping out, which looks like a tail. That is bird beak or a rat tail appearance. Lastly, therapy is Heller's laparoscopic myotomy. Or pneumatic balloon dilatation can also be performed. That is, a balloon is inserted at the lower end of the esophagus and it is dilated. Pneumatic balloon dilatation. Now think of it as the next level of question. most common complication of pneumatic balloon dilatation. When you are dilating the lower end of the esophagus, it can get dilated more, in turn leading to GRD or reflux. So GRD is in turn the complication of pneumatic balloon dilatation. This is achalasia, cardia, and in the question, numerous hints were given. That is, manometry shows absence of esophageal peristalsis, LES that fails to relax. Classical achalasia cardia. Next, this gets us to question 87. Young female, diarrhea, fatigue, significant weight loss, endoscopy, special diet with no wheat or barley. Now, very obvious. Patient has been started by the clinician or the physician on a special diet without wheat or barley. This improved her symptoms. So which of the following microscopic findings are seen in the specimen? Lymphatic obstruction, no. Non-caseating granulomas, no. Firstly, tell me the diagnosis. Celiac disease, that is gluten sensitive enteropathy, celiac disease. Celiac disease microscopically shows villus atrophy with crypt hyperplasia. So atrophy of villi with blunting and flattening, yes, and increased intraepithelial lymphocytes, yes. So answer is 3 and 5 are correct. That is option E. Question 87. The answer is E. That is 3 and 5 are correct. And the diagnosis in that case was celiac disease. Diagnosis was celiac disease, also called as gluten sensitive enteropathy. Celiac disease or gluten sensitive enteropathy. Gluten sensitive enteropathy. Let us have a look at this. Gluten, the name tells you everything. The patient is sensitive to gluten. Gluten is a component of wheat. So the patient cannot eat the component of wheat. So the patient cannot eat vrob, that is wheat, rye, oats, barley. He cannot eat this. Next point. Now we have gluten-free products available everywhere. Earlier the question was asked what the patient can eat. He can eat maize, but not at present. Next point. Microscopically. What we see normally is in the intestine is the presence of villi and crypts. What is going up is villi, coming down is crypt. This is normal. Versus celiac disease, which shows flattening of villi with crypt hyperplasia. It has gotten flattened from the top, hyperplastic from bottom. Flattening of villi with crypt hyperplasia along with the presence of intraepithelial lymphocytes. Next point, because of crypt hyperplasia, the total thickness of mucosa. Total thickness of mucosa is maintained. This is celiac disease, microscopy. Next point, which is the diagnostic microscopic hallmark of celiac disease? Flattening of villi, no. Crypt hyperplasia, no. Nahi bachche, do not fall into that trap. These features, that is HPE, histopath examination, HPE is non-diagnostic or non-specific in nature. It is non-diagnostic or non-specific. That means just by looking at the biopsy, as a pathologist, I cannot make a diagnosis of celiac disease. These features can be non-specifically seen with other diseases also. This is celiac. Next point, which HLA alleles are associated with celiac disease? HLA-DQ2/DQ8, seen in about 98% of the patients. Which skin lesion? DH, dermatitis herpetiformis. DH, dermatitis herpetiformis. Next point, which part of the intestine is more severely affected? Proximal intestine or distal? Proximal intestine. More severely affected, proximal intestine. See, proximal intestine is more exposed to gluten. So, more severely affected, proximal intestine. The patient is having food orally. So, proximal intestine is more exposed to gluten. Versus, when the patient stops having gluten, on stopping gluten, what heals first? Proximal intestine or distal? Distal intestine, because it was less severely affected. So, after stopping gluten, healing progresses. After stopping gluten, healing progresses distal to proximal. That is distal to cephalid, distal to proximal. This is celiac disease. This is celiac. Next, this gets us to our next question. That is question 88. Question 88, match the following. We have to match the left hand side with the right. Question 88. Now, the answer is A. Carcinomas are cytokeratin positive. A4, carcinoma cytokeratin. Lymphoma CD45. A4B1, sarcomas vimentin. Melanoma HMB45. D5, HMB45, neuroendocrine tumors, NAC, neuron-specific NLS. So, answer is B, that is A4. Question 88. The answer is B, that is A4, A4, B1, C3, D5, and A2. Now, before we go further, let us have a look at the various markers for various conditions. Firstly, starting with carcinomas. Carcinomas are cytokeratin positive versus sarcomas, which are vimentin positive. Next, lymphomas. We have already made this list in a previous question. Lymphomas, which is the pan leukocyte marker? CD45, also called as LCA. Lymphomas, LCA, leukocyte common antigen. Lymphomas, CD45 or LCA. Next, melanomas. Melanoma, it is melanomas, that is S100 and HMB45. Which is more specific with melanomas? S100 or HMB45? HMB45, more specific. This means that S100, other than melanoma, would also be associated with other conditions like Langerhans cell histiocytosis, LCH. Langerhans cell histiocytosis. This is also S100 positive. Langerhans cell histiocytosis. Next, GFAP. Glial fibrillary acidic protein. GFAP. Glial fibrillary acidic protein. GFAP. This is positive for gliomas. This is positive for gliomas and CNS tumors. Gliomas or other CNS tumors. GFAP. Next, last is smooth muscle. For smooth muscle, we look at desmin. Desmin or muscle-specific actin. Desmin or muscle-specific actin. These are the various immunohistochemistries associated with these tumors. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 89. 36, female, intermittent pelvic pain. right ovary mass, papillary tumor, which of the following is basic defect producing these abnormal structures? Now, what the patient is telling you is there is a 36-year middle-aged female with a papillary ovarian tumor showing you seminoma bodies. So, round laminated calcifications, seminoma bodies. Seminoma bodies are a type of which calcification? We have already done this in cell injury. So, calcifications are of two types, metastatic, dystrophic. It is a dystrophic calcification. 89, the answer is B. Question 89, the answer is B, that is, it is a type of dystrophic calcification. It is a type of dystrophic calcification. And these laminated structures were seminoma bodies. They were seminoma bodies. Next point. So let us have a look at list of tumors associated with seminoma bodies. They are papillary RCC, papillary renal cell carcinoma, papillary thyroid carcinoma, PTC, papillary thyroid carcinoma. Next, serous cyst adenocarcinoma ovary. Please note, it is not mucinous, serous. Serous cyst adenocarcinoma ovary, mesothelioma, meningioma, and prolactinoma. Meningioma and prolactinoma. These are the tumors associated with seminoma bodies. Next point, seminoma bodies, they are a type of dystrophic calcification. They are a type of dystrophic calcification in which, now you very well know this, dystrophic calcifications is associated with tumors or necrosed areas. So what is the serum calcium in dystrophic calcification? Normal. In which serum calcium levels are normal. We have already seen the differences between metastatic and dystrophic calcification. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 90. Enzyme that protects the brain from free radical injury is SOD, superoxide dismutase. Question 90. The answer is B, that is superoxide dismutase. Now, before we go further, let us have a look at free radicals. Let us start from the beginning, both generation and removal of free radicals. First point, what are free radicals? Free radicals, they are substances with an unpaired electron in outer orbit. Free radicals, they have an unpaired electron in outer orbit. So, are they very stable or are they inherently unstable? They are inherently unstable. They are unstable in nature. So, they are highly reactive. Next point, how are they generated? That is, generation of free radicals. The first mechanism is the reduction oxidation reactions that occur during normal metabolic processes. The reduction oxidation reactions. Next, they are generated during inflammation. They are generated by the NADPH oxidase pathway. And which free radicals are generated by the NADPH oxidase pathway? The superoxide anion, O2-, superoxide anion, and hypochlorous anion, HOCl-, superoxide anion and the hypochlorous anion. Next, during inflammation, they are also generated by the nitric oxide synthase pathway, NOS, nitric oxide synthase pathway. And which free radical is generated by the nitric oxide synthase pathway? It is the peroxy nitrite, ONOO-, peroxy nitrite, peroxy nitrite, ONOO-. This is generation of free radicals. The last mechanism, is by transition metals. Transition metals, that is Fenton's reaction, which includes iron. Fenton's reaction, not interested. This is generation of free radicals. Next point, this gets us to removal of free radicals. This was what the question was based on. Removal of free radicals. Now, there are three main mechanisms by which the free radicals are removed. The first is they are inherently unstable. As a result, they decay spontaneously. First point, they decay spontaneously. They are inherently unstable, so they decay spontaneously. The second mechanism for removal is by enzymes. It is by enzymes. Three main enzymes play a role, which are catalases. Enzymes, which are catalases which are present in peroxisomes. Catalases present in peroxisomes, they convert H2O2 to H2O plus O2. Catalases. Next is SOD, superoxide dismutase. SOD, superoxide dismutase. This enzyme is of two types, copper zinc superoxide dismutase and manganese superoxide dismutase. Copper zinc superoxide dismutase is present in cytoplasm versus manganese superoxide dismutase, which is present in mitochondria. Easy to remember, M for manganese, M for mitochondria. Superoxide dismutase, this also converts H2O2 to H2O plus O2. The last enzyme is glutathione peroxidase. So three enzymes which play a role: catalase, superoxide dismutase and glutathione peroxidase. This is the second mechanism. And the last mechanism for removal of free radicals is non-enzymatic removal, which is by vitamins, which occurs by lipid-soluble vitamin A and E. Vitamin A and E and the proteins, that is transferrin, which is binding iron, and ceruloplasmin, which is binding copper. So three mechanisms, they decay inherently, enzymes and non-enzymatic removal. So coming back to the question, it was enzyme that protects the brain from free radical injury, superoxide dismutase. Next. So this gets us to our next question, that is question 91. Now let us have a look at this. It is on the next page. So just a sec. Increased incidence of cancer in old age is due to, and the answer is telomerase reactivation. The answer is 1, that is telomerase reactivation. 91, telomerase reactivation. This causes increased risk of cancers. Now, what do we mean by this? See, normally, let me write this for you. Normally, after a fixed number of mitosis, the cell reaches a terminally non-dividing state. That is, it is not able to divide or replicate further. This normal process is called as replicative senescence. Replicative senescence. It is not able to divide further. Next point, why does this occur? because the telomeres are shortened. Telomeres, next point, telomeres, they are present at telomeres, they are present at ends of the chromosome. They are present at ends of the chromosome. With each mitosis or with each division, they shorten. With each division, they shorten. Next point, their length is maintained by, next point, their length of telomeres is maintained by an enzyme. It is maintained by an enzyme called as telomerase. Length of telomeres is maintained by telomerase. This is normal. Now, in case of tumors, in cancers or in tumors, it is associated with increased telomerase activity. It is associated with increased telomerase activity, as a result of which the telomere shortening will not take place, so the tumor cells do not undergo replicative senescence. Let me repeat. See, normally after a fixed number of divisions, the cells stop multiplying. This is called as replicative senescence. This is replicative senescence. Why does replicative senescence occur? Because the telomeres shorten beyond a certain cutoff. Telomeres are present at ends of the chromosome. Their length is maintained by telomerase activity. In tumors or in cancer cells, the telomerase activity is increased in turn preventing the shortening of telomeres. So, cancer in elderly occurs because of telomerase reactivation. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 92. Question 92. Retired man complains of abdominal pain since 6 months, acute chest pain with dyspnea, abdominal CT, pulmonary embolus, 7.5 cm mass in pancreas, CA 99 with genetic. So, this is a long question, but question 92, the only important statement is the last line. Which genetic mutation is likely to be associated with pancreatic cancer? Throughout the question, the examiner is hinting towards pancreatic cancer associated with mutation in KRAS. 92, the answer is B, that is KRAS. The diagnosis in this case, was pancreatic carcinoma with Trousseau syndrome. How do we know that it is associated with Trousseau syndrome? Because it was associated with pulmonary thromboembolism. So, pulmonary thromboembolism in a case of pancreatic cancer is Trousseau syndrome. Pulmonary thromboembolism. Next point, CA and CA 99 were also elevated. Anyways, not concerned with that here. Next, so the gene mutation associated predominantly with pancreatic carcinoma is the KRAS gene mutation. Having a look at others, PRSS1 mutation. This is also associated with pancreatic cancer with hereditary pancreatitis. Pancreatic cancer associated with hereditary pancreatitis. So this is not the best answer. Next, the next option was SPINK1. This is associated only with hereditary pancreatitis. It is associated with hereditary pancreatitis, not pancreatic cancer. And the last was BRCA2. BRCA2, you very well know, is breast cancer, ovarian cancer. Which type of breast cancer? ER positive, HER2 negative, luminal B breast cancer. We have already seen that. So, question 92, the answer is B, that is KRAS. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is 93. that is 93, which is not used as a tumor marker in testicular tumors. Alpha fetoprotein, Yorck sac tumor. LDH, seminomas. HCG, choriocarcinoma. CEA, no, that is not used. So question 93, the answer is D, that is CEA. Cancer is T, that is CEA, carcinoembryonic antigen. CEA, it is non-specifically elevated. CEA, it is non-specifically elevated in lung cancers, lung, colon, and pancreatic cancers. It is non-specifically elevated in lung, colon, and pancreatic carcinomas. Next point, but it is not associated or is not used for testicular cancers. Next, this gets us to our next one, that is question 94. All of the following are true regarding lipofuscin. Now, firstly, have a look, forget everything, just have an unbiased, no history look at this image. What does this show you? What is the parent organ? Liver. What you are able to see are the presence of hepatocytes, large cells, abundant cytoplasm, central nucleus, hepatocytes present in chains. Liver with an arrow which is present on the golden brown pigment, lipofuscin. So this slide itself is sufficient to tell you that this is lipofuscin deposit in liver. So the examiner might not have written the word lipofuscin. You could have made it out just from the image. Now all are true except lipofuscin is insoluble wear and tear pigment. This is true. It microscopically appears yellow brown, is fine granular. Option B is also true. Next, injurious to cell and its function. Nahi bache, lipofuscin is not injurious to the cell. It is an aging related pigment, but it is not injurious. So 3 is wrong. It denotes occurrence of free radical injury and lipid peroxidation. Yes, this is true. So question 94, the answer is C, that it is injurious to health. It is injurious to health, cell and its function. Cell and its function. This is false. Rest of the statements associated with lipofuscin, associated with aging. It is a pigment associated with aging. Wear and tear pigment of the body. Telltale sign of free radical injury. Telltale sign of free radical injury. Free radical injury. Next, microscopically golden brown in color. And lastly, the stain used is the long ZN stain, that is the long Z Nielsen stain. You very well know ZN staining is used for tuberculosis, TB, long ZN, the staining time is increased, long ZN stain, lipofuscin. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 95. Marfan's, the defect is in fibrillin 1. A. Question 95. The answer is A. That is, it is a defect in fibrillin 1. So before we go further, let us have a look at Marfan's syndrome. First point, Marfan's, the name tells you everything. Marfan, chromosome 15, gene FBN1, associated with the protein fibrillin 1. Marfan, 15, FBN1, fibrillin 1. Next point, inheritance pattern. Marfan syndrome, it is autosomal dominant. Next point, clinically it is associated with disorders in skeletal system. It is associated with disorders in the skeletal system, CVS, cardiovascular system, and ocular abnormalities. Clinically, it is associated with defects in the skeletal system, CVS, and ocular abnormalities. starting with the defects in skeletal system. In the skeletal system, in the skeletal, how is the patient? Is he a dwarf or is he very tall? He is very tall. In the skeletal system, he is tall with long extremities. He is tall with long extremities, long tapering fingers, long tapering fingers. The fingers of the patient are long and tapering. He is extremely tall. He is extremely tall, long tapering fingers. Is double jointed. Double jointed. Double jointed means like we can flex between arm and the wrist, we can flex only at the elbow joint, but he can even flex in the middle, not to the full extent but to some extent. He is double jointed. Next, there is hyper extensibility. There is hyper extensibility due to laxity of joint ligaments. Due to laxity, laxity of joint ligaments. He is hyper extensible, meaning we can only extend our elbow to 180 degrees. He can go slightly beyond that. Hyper extensibility due to laxity of the joint ligaments. Next, it is also associated with spine deformities. Spine deformities, that is kyphosis or scoliosis. Spine deformities, that is kyphosis or scoliosis. These are the skeletal abnormalities. These are the skeletal abnormalities. Next, coming to CVS abnormalities. Coming to the cardiovascular system, CVS abnormalities. The most common lesion associated with Marfan's is mitral valve prolapse. Most common is mitral valve prolapse versus the most common cause of death, which is aortic dissection. Most common cause of death in Marfan's, aortic dissection. So CVS abnormalities, the most common CVS lesion associated with Marfan's, mitral valve prolapse. Most common cause of death, aortic dissection. Clinically, skeletal, CVS. And the last is ocular abnormalities. Among ocular, it is associated with subluxation of the lens. Where is the eye lens going? Superiorly and temporally, that is upward and outward. This is suprotemporal subluxation of the lens. Suprotemporal subluxation of the lens, ocular abnormalities. This is clinically what Marfan syndrome is associated with. Lastly, last point, diagnostic criteria for Marfan's diagnosis. It is associated with the modified Gentz criteria. Marfan's syndrome, it is associated with modified Gentz criteria for Marfan's. Next point. This gets us to our next question, that is question 96. Males are more commonly affected than females in X-linked recessive disorders. Absolutely nothing to even ask in this. See, autosomal recessive and autosomal dominant are not sex dependent. X-linked recessive is male predominant, X-linked dominant are female predominant. So question 96, the answer is X-linked recessive disorders. Answer is C, that is X-linked recessive disorders, X-linked recessive, which are male predominant. Nothing major to discuss in this. What is important for us is X-linked dominant diseases, they are female predominant. X-linked dominant, they are female predominant. This is important. Why? There are two reasons for X-linked dominant being female predominant. The first is greater number of X chromosomes in the female, greater number of X chromosomes in the female. And the next is some X-linked dominant diseases are lethal in utero. They are lethal in utero in males. That is, the child dies in the womb of the mother if he is suffering from an X-linked dominant disease. So, two reasons why X-linked dominant are female predominant. Which is the main reason for female predominance? Greater number or lethal in utero? Greater number. The main reason being greater number of X chromosomes. Next point, which is the only X-linked dominant disease which is male predominant? Alport syndrome. The only exception to this is Alport syndrome. It is an X-linked dominant disease but is male predominant. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 97. Cell surface molecule involved in peripheral tolerance induction are? Answer is B7 and CD28, that is option 1. Cell surface involved in peripheral tolerance induction. Answer is A, B7 and CD28. Now, this was a good question. Peripheral tolerance. Now, you very well know that self-tolerance is of two types. Firstly, what is self-tolerance? Self-tolerance means inability of the immune system to act against self-antigens. That is, my immune system will not act against my own antigens. Self-tolerance is of two types. Central tolerance and peripheral tolerance. Central tolerance acts where the cells mature. Where do the B cells mature? Bone marrow. Where do the T cells mature? Thymus. So let us assume that I have a self-reactive B cell in my bone marrow. My bone marrow has a B cell, which when it will come in the peripheral blood, it will act against my own antigens. So what does the body do? In the bone marrow, it undergoes gene rearrangements. So if the genes of this B cell are rearranged, when it will come in peripheral blood, it will not recognize self antigens. Versus if I have a self-reactive T cell in my thymus, this T cell should not come in peripheral blood because after coming in the peripheral blood, it will react against self-antigens. So, it undergoes deletions or apoptosis. This is central tolerance. Next, peripheral tolerance. This is mainly for T cells. Meaning, if I had a self-reactive T cell in my thymus, it should have undergone apoptosis. But suppose apoptosis did not occur. This T cell came in the peripheral blood. Now what? Now it will recognize self-antigens. Body does not want that. So this gets us to mechanisms of peripheral tolerance. This was what was asked. Mechanisms of peripheral tolerance. The first mechanism of peripheral tolerance is energy. Now, energy, what does it mean? Firstly, T cell needs two signals for getting activated. Signal 1 is received when the T cell receptor binds with the antigen. Will signal 1 be received in this case? Yes, because this is a self-reactive T cell, it will be able to bind with self-antigens. So, signal 1 is received. But signal 2 for T cell activation, which is received by CD28, present on T cells, binding with CD86 or CD80, also called as the B7 proteins on the antigen presenting cell. I'll repeat. Signal 2 is received by CD28 present on T cells binding with CD80 or 86 present on antigen presenting cells. CD80 or 86 is also called as the B7 protein. The signal 2 for T cell activation is not received, as a result of which the T cell will not get activated. This is energy. This is energy. Next, the next mechanism of peripheral tolerance is suppression by regulatory T cells. Suppression by the regulatory T cells. How do we identify the regulatory T cells? Regulatory T cells, they are CD4 positive, CD25 positive, FOXP3 positive. 4 positive, 25 positive, FOXP3 positive. So, if FOXP3 is mutated, that is, in FOXP3 mutations, the name of the disease is IPAX, which is immune dysregulation. Immune dysregulation. Polyendocrinopathy, enteropathy, and it is X-linked in nature. IPAX. This is the second mechanism of peripheral tolerance, suppression by the regulatory T cells, and the last mechanism of peripheral tolerance is apoptosis by extrinsic pathway. You very well know extrinsic is the Fas ligand pathway. These are the mechanisms of peripheral tolerance, three mechanisms. So what the examiner asked you was, peripheral tolerance is mediated. Peripheral surface molecules involved in peripheral tolerance are CD28 and B7, because the second signal for T cell activation is not received. Next, hyperacute rejection is because of formation of preformed antibodies. A, question 98, the answer is A. Hyperacute graft rejection. This occurs because of preformed antibodies. So before we go further, this gets us to graft rejection. Let us look at the mechanisms. Now, whenever I study graft rejection, I assume that I am the recipient. I took the graft, my body rejected it. Graft rejection. Graft rejection occurs by three main mechanisms. So let us make a flowchart. Hyperacute, acute, and chronic graft rejection. Hyperacute, acute, chronic. First point, hyperacute graft rejection. This occurs within minutes to hours. Acute occurs within days to months, versus chronic, which is within months to years, Next point, hyperacute graft rejection. This occurs because of presence of preformed antibody. It occurs because of preformed antibody in the recipient. I took the graft, my body rejected it. Graft rejection. Next point. Which type of hypersensitivity reaction is this? 1, 2, 3, 4. It is type 2 hypersensitivity. See, you very well know, one is allergy or asthma. Type 2 is antibody mediated. 3 is antigen, antibody immune complex. 4 is cell mediated or delayed type. This is antibody mediated, that is type 2 hypersensitivity. Next point, microscopically. Microscopically, it is associated with fibrinoid necrosis. Microscopically, fibrinoid necrosis and thrombotic occlusion of capillaries. We have made the list of fibrinoid necrosis once earlier also. The causes were malignant hypertension, PAN, acute phase, SLE, lupus nephritis, Lippmann sac endocarditis, graft rejection, hyperacute type, and RHD. So, 5 diseases with fibrinoid necrosis. We have done this. This was hyperacute graft rejection. Hyperacute graft rejection. Next is acute. Acute graft rejection, it is of two types. It is of two types, that is humoral and cellular. Acute graft rejection is of two types, humoral, cellular. Humoral is antibody mediated versus cellular, which is cell mediated, obviously. Humoral acute graft rejection, it is which type of hypersensitivity? 1, 2, 3, 4. It is type 2, that is antibody mediated hypersensitivity versus cellular, which is type 4 hypersensitivity, type 4. Next point, important point to be here, noted here is microscopically, extremely important, humoral, it is associated with deposition of C4D, complement factor 4D, where? In peritubular capillaries, deposition of C4D in peritubular capillaries, in peritubular capillaries versus cellular, which is associated with endotheliitis and tubulitis, versus cellular, which is endotheliitis, that is inflammation of endothelial cells and tubules. Not interested. This is acute graft rejection. Last is chronic graft rejection. It is again of two types, humoral, cellular. Humoral is type 2 hypersensitivity, cellular is type 4 hypersensitivity. You know this. In chronic, cellular is more common, and microscopically it is associated with fibrosis. This is graft rejection. This table again is important. Numerous questions come from this. This is graft rejection, has to be remembered. Next, this gets us to our next question, that is question 99. 60 female, renal failure on hemodialysis, developed carpal tunnel. Which of the following is associated? So, which protein is getting deposited in hemodialysis associated amyloidosis? Beta 2 microglobulin. We have just around 10-20 questions ago only made this flowchart. So, question 99. The answer is D. That is beta 2 microglobulin, that is hemodialysis associated amyloidosis. Next, this gets us to the next one, that is question 100. Which type of amyloidosis is caused by mutation in transthyretin? Again, we have done this. Transfamilial Mediterranean fever, it is mutation in AA. Amyloidotic neuropathies, transthyretin. Dialysis associated amyloidosis, beta 2 microglobulin. So the answer is B, familial amyloidotic neuropathies. Question 100. The answer is B, that is familial amyloidotic neuropathies. We have already seen the various types of proteins getting deposited in amyloidosis, familial amyloidotic neuropathies. Next point, let us have one more look at amyloidosis and the salient features. It is intracellular deposition or extracellular? Extracellular. Amyloidosis, extracellular deposition of abnormally folded protein. Next point. Next point. On infrared spectro, on X-ray crystallography, on X-ray crystallography, or infrared spectroscopy, X-ray crystallography or infrared spectroscopy, it shows the presence of beta-pleated sheets. It shows the presence of beta-pleated sheets. Next point, electron microscopy, branching or non-branching fibrils? Non-branching. It shows non-branching fibrils. It shows non-branching, that is, they are present in a straight manner. Non-branching fibrils, which are 7.5 to 10 nanometers in diameter. 7.5 to 10 nanometers in diameter. Last point in amyloidosis, the most specific site of biopsy. Most specific site of biopsy is the rectal biopsy. Most specific site of biopsy is the rectal biopsy. These are the other salient features associated with amyloidosis. Next. This gets us to our next question, that is question 101. Now, before we go further, let us have a look at few microscopies. I wanted to discuss this. These are the GIT microscopies, the question of which we did earlier. First point, diagnosis. Now you see two images in this answer. The first image, it shows the presence of villi crypts. Villi crypts, that is, this is normal. Versus the second image, which shows flattening of villi with crypt hyperplasia. The total thickness is maintained. Diagnosis, celiac disease. Next point, diagnosis. Now, what we see here is a pedunculated structure showing these large four areas. We have already seen this image. Answer, tubulovillous adenoma. This is the characteristic architecture. What we see at the ends are the villi, whereas these are the tubules. Even if you are not able to make out the tubules, this is the classical architecture of tubulovillous adenoma. We have already seen the genes associated with tubulovillous adenoma. They are APC, WNT, beta-catenin, and KRAS. APC, WNT, beta-catenin, and KRAS. We have seen that. Next, diagnosis. What we see here is the presence of numerous serrations. We see the presence of glands with numerous serrations. What do we mean by serrations? Knife has those serrations. It has rugged edges, serrations. So diagnosis, sessile serrated adenoma, which belongs to which pathway? MSI, microsatellite instability, or the DNA mismatch repair pathway, SSA, sessile serrated adenoma. Next, diagnosis. Now, there are two structures in this, on the top and bottom. Which is the affected portion, the top one or the bottom one? The bottom one is affected, showing you the presence of large cells with something pink inside them. That is, all these are the macrophages containing PAS positive granules, periodic acid shift positive. PAS positive granules in macrophages, in lamina propria. Diagnosis, Whipple's disease. Next. So before we go to the next microscopy, this gets us to our next question, that is question 101.